shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond.
Find light in the beautiful sea. I chose to be happy. You and I, you and I. We're like diamonds in the sky. You're a shooting star I see. A vision of ecstasy. When you hold me, I'm alive. We're like diamonds in the sky.
Chairperson this evening. My name is Barbara Attlee, the Consul General for the Cooperative Republic of Guyana. His Excellency David Granger, President of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana. Her Excellency Mrs. Sandra Granger, First Lady of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana. Honorable Carr Greenidge, Second Vice President and Minister of Foreign Affairs. Honorable Don Hastings Williams, Minister of Public Affairs within the Ministry of the Presidency. Ambassador Audrey Waddle, Director General, Ministry of Foreign Affairs. His Excellency Ambassador Rudolph Tanpao, Permanent Representative to Guyana, to the United Nations. Senator Roxanne Pusson, Ms. Catherine Pollard, UN Undersecretary General, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, members of our great diaspora. Good evening.
Good evening.
I didn't hear you.
Good evening.
Thank you. Allow me on behalf of the permanent mission to the United Nations of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana to extend a warm welcome to each and every one of you, our dear invited guests here this evening. Welcome to this, the James Madison Room at the Princeton Club. And I know our president is a historian and an author, and I hope the ambiance befits him. We're here this evening to participate and to share in a little meet and greet reception with our President, His Excellency David Granger. Our President is here in New York with his delegation attending the 72nd session of the United Nations General Assembly. I take this opportunity to recognize the members of his delegation who are assembled here. I don't see Ambassador Waldo. And we have his press team as well as his other advisors. So we really want to welcome them as well. We want to say thanks to the delegation for so aptly representing our country, keeping at the forefront of the debate the Guyana-Venezuela controversy. And we recognize and we are cognizant of your busy schedule and are delighted that you were able to be here with us this evening. The theme for the 72nd session of the United Nations General Assembly was focusing on people, striving for peace and a decent life for all on a sustainable planet. When I saw this theme, I recognized that the theme is very befitting of our president, whose focus and direction for our country is reflected in that theme. And I'm sure we'll hear more about it. Ladies and gentlemen, members of the diaspora, we recognize and thank each and every one of you for your contributions that you have made to our country, dear land of Guyana, and the part that you continue to play. This event affords you the opportunity to meet and interact with our president and other members in the diaspora. His Excellency has seized this opportunity to meet and greet members of the diaspora. Ladies and gentlemen, I now have the distinct pleasure to introduce our president, His Excellency Brigadier David Granger. But I must say a few words about him. His Excellency President David Granger was sworn in as our 9th Executive President on the 16th of May, 2015. He's a remarkable man who has had a distinguished career. He has been an outstanding officer in the Guyana Defense Force, attaining the rank of Brigadier General. He was also a National Security Advisor to the late President Desmond Hoyt. He's a publicist, a renowned academic, a prolific author, a scholar, adjunct professor, and a visionary politician. He received various awards and holds 3 national awards for distinguished military service. Our president is very passionate about Guyana's pursuit of a green economy. Guyana is among the countries collaborating to alleviate the threat posed by the climate change phenomenon. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me immense pleasure to invite His Excellency to address you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Council General, Vice President and Minister of Foreign Affairs, Carl Greenwich, Minister of Public Affairs, Don Hastings Williams, Ambassador Michael Tenpao, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I'm happy to be here again among the diaspora. I was here last year to celebrate our 50th anniversary of independence, along with other distinguished Guyanese such as Baroness Valerie Amos and CCH Punger. And it's always good to come and interact with members of the diaspora to find out what they're thinking and also to express our gratitude for the support and solidarity of the diaspora to our home country, Guyana. Guyanese, why are we here? We're here in pursuit of the national interest. We come up to New York every year, not on a holiday, but to work to ensure that our national interests, to ensure that the interests of the Guyanese people are met. This is a particularly significant year because we expect in a few hours' time to meet with the United Nations Secretary General, Mr. Antonio Guterres, on a very important matter that has affected our development throughout our independent history, the question of our territorial sovereignty and integrity. I spoke at the United Nations General Assembly 2 days ago, and as the Council General pointed out, I extracted from the theme of this year's General Assembly meeting three words: our focus on people, the desire for peace, and the need to preserve the planet. PPP. Did I say that? Seriously, this is the theme of the United Nations General Assembly meeting, and this is the earnest belief of the Guyana delegation. Let me start with the last P, the planet. At this moment, our brothers and sisters in the Caribbean, in Antigua and Barbuda, in Dominica, in British Virgin Islands, have suffered the storm of a lifetime, something perhaps they never dreamt could have occurred with such ferocity. We are in an era of climate change, of global warming, and unless the world takes cognizance of the causes of these hurricanes, we will, particularly in the Caribbean, continue to be victims of these furious storms. There is no doubt in my mind, and there is no doubt in the mind of most people who have taken the trouble to examine the phenomenon of global warming and climate change, that during summer, late summer, when the waters of the Atlantic become warm, they precipitate hurricanes moving westward, always through the Caribbean. And this time, this year, the most fierce hurricane has moved all the way up to Texas, Hurricane Harvey, followed by his sisters Irma, followed by Jose, followed by Maria, followed by Lee, followed by Katia, followed by Norma. I hope it doesn't mean Zena. But the point is that as the waters become warmer, the hurricanes are more frequent and more fierce. So unless we understand the changes that are taking place in the planet, our people in the Caribbean will continue to be victims of this serious annual series of storms. Guyana is very fortunate because we are part of the Guyana Shield, which is a very important geographical and ecological and biological feature. We ourselves are not victims of these furious hurricanes, but we contribute to the mitigation, we contribute to the cooling of the earth, because even at the present time, our country is still covered with 75% forests. We help the earth to breathe. We help the earth to keep cool when others are getting warm. We've always been cool. But this question of climate change is extremely serious. We care for the planet. Guyana has adopted the cognomen Green State because we intend to be green. We intend to continue to contribute to the cooling and the greening of Mother Earth. If I can turn to the second P, that is our people. We in the Caribbean, as you know, are victims of one of the largest movements of human beings in the history of Earth. 525 years ago, 88 illegal immigrants came into the Caribbean. Unregistered, unlawful. 88 of them. Three boats. But since that time, the Caribbean has become the cockpit of Europe. Since that time, we've had British, French, Dutch, Portuguese, Spanish, Swedish, German, all of these European countries came into the Caribbean and made it into a cockpit. Not a cockpit in an airplane, but a cockpit where dogs fight. But it's time to stop fighting. It is time that we understand that the entire region is under threat. And that we have to protect our people. We have to ensure that the rights which were denied to our people in the past, human rights, civil rights, are no longer denied to them. We have to ensure that people could become rich and more and prosperous like other countries. We have to eliminate illiteracy and poverty. And the protection of our people, ensuring that they can enjoy a good life, good education, full employment, is one of the reasons why we're here in New York, to work with the international community to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. And thirdly, peace. As I said, for 525 years, people have been fighting over the Caribbean. The Caribbean, up to now, is still the most balkanized area of Earth. There's no other part of the Earth where there's so many different jurisdictions. We in the Caribbean community have taken the boldest step to bring people together. Right now, the Caribbean community contains French-speaking Haitians, Dutch-speaking Surinamese. And in years to come, we will expand. But we have accepted that the Caribbean people deserve a better life, a better future. And we want, in CARICOM, to create a platform where the people of these territories, not only Anglophone Caribbean, but all of the Caribbean territories, could look forward to a good life. The Anglophone Caribbean alone, added to the mainland Caribbean states of Belize and Guyana, and of course Suriname, are the size of Sweden. We're not little islands. We're a big state the size of Sweden. And if we combine not only our land space, but to combine our intelligence and our resources, I am confident that in our lifetime, we can achieve a much higher standard of living. So I leave with you our commitment to improving the lives of our people, to establishing peace, and to protecting our planet. For Guyanese, it is important that we meet with United Nations Secretary General, Mr. Antonio Guterres. As you know, the United Nations Secretary General is perhaps the only person on Earth who has the authority to bring this controversy to what we consider a successful and lawful and peaceful conclusion. And we will go to see him to plead on your behalf to use his authority to bring this controversy to a successful conclusion. We have suffered too long. We've been denied investments. Businessmen have been chased out. Foreign warships have come into our waters and expelled. It's no secret. Expelled peaceful exploration vessels. We cannot go forward in the future if other countries deny our people the right to exploit their God-given resources. Now, particularly, that we're about to embark on a new industry, we want to remind the United Nations that it has a duty to protect small states. We will never have a big army. We'll never have a big navy. And we don't want war. How could we want war? We want the United Nations to recognize in this community, in this hemisphere, that it has the duty to protect small states like ours. So our being here is not a ritual, it's not an empty ceremonial event. It is work. And we have work to do to ensure that you have a home to come back to. Fellow Guyanese, we have no doubt that you love your country. You don't have to be boastful, but just recognize that we have a beautiful, bountiful, blissful country with amazing biodiversity. We have a country which possesses a couple of dozen of the most unique animals in the world, over 850 species of birds, the largest freshwater fish, the largest caiman, the largest rodents. And the ladies like this one. The ladies like this one, the largest spider. Spider's big as your shoe. But these animals require the forest as their habitat. That is why we protect the forest. As the Amerindians say, trees hold up the sky. If you cut down the trees, the sky will fall. So protection of the forest, again, is an important part, not only for biodiversity, but for policy. So when we speak of petroleum exploration, when we speak of the prospect of becoming an oil state, we are not abandoning our commitment to biodiversity. We walk on two legs. We will become a green state, and we will use the petroleum profits to develop the infrastructure and develop the other requirements of the people of our country. We live under the curse of the six sisters. As long as you can remember, Guyana is dependent on sugar and rice, bauxite, gold, diamonds, timber. And they've been faithful to us over the years. But some of them tired. We need to diversify. We need to get away from the spell of these six sisters and ensure that our children have a future other than being cane cutters. Our children have a future other than felling timber. We have to go into manufacturing, we have to go into new industries. And we feel that petroleum is going to be transformative from an economic point of view. So we're not going to blister our landscape, we're not going to destroy our biodiversity, our beautiful rivers and waterfalls and our lakes. We are going to ensure that new industries fit into our landscape and fit into our plan for the economic development of our country. And that is where I turn to you, the members of the diaspora. We don't need more barrels, we need brains. That's why I'm here. We all know about the age of the barrels when you pack stuff to send to your family, to your relatives. But now, Guyana is ready to take off. We need your intellectual capital. We need to tap into the expertise and experience which you have gained here in the diaspora. You've heard me say this before, that Guyana is a nation divided into half in North America, half in South America. I know where the rich half is. South America. Come on, we have more resources than you. But you have that intellectual capital. And with your intellect and our resources, we can bring the two sides together. And we can move our population from 750,000 to a million, I'm sure, a million and a half. First of all, we welcome your investment. Guyana has the resources, and the doors are open to business, to investment. We cannot do it alone. We need factories, we need manufacture. We don't want to export raw lumber. We want to export the best furniture in South America. We don't want to export raw gold. We don't want people smuggling our gold. We want to export the finest jewelry that can come out of the region. We need investment to move our raw materials into the realm of well-manufactured products. We can do it. Other countries have done it. Other countries use our gold. Other countries use our timber. Other countries use our bauxite. Our countries use our fish. So we need your investment to help to develop these industries. This is my message to you this evening. I know you have other questions on your minds, but I bring a message of hope. I'm very confident that the changes which are taking place in Guyana will be able to ensure that our people get a good life, will ensure that the solutions that we aim at in the Caribbean will help to enhance peace, make Caribbean a zone of peace, and ensure that Guyana, above all other Caribbean countries, will continue to contribute to making this planet home for all humanity. Thank you, and may God bless you.
Excellency, we wish to thank you for your inspiring discourse with the members of the diaspora. Thanks for bringing us up to date with developments and reminding us of the rich potential that Guyana holds for all Guyanese. Ladies and gentlemen, as you absorb and deliberate the words of His Excellency, I'm sure that you are further encouraged to continue to be an integral part of the social and economic development of our dear land of Guyana. I wish to take this opportunity as the Council General to make two brief announcements. The first is that there will be a Government of Guyana Diaspora Engagement Consultation at York College tomorrow, the 23rd of September, from 1 p.m. until 4 p.m. We have the flyers at the back, so please make sure that you take a flyer that will give you some more information. And this is a follow-up to the consultation that was held last year here in New York. The draft strategy is ready, and so that will be presented, and we would like to glean some more insight from the diaspora itself. So we are encouraging you to be part of this consultation. Secondly, His Excellency mentioned about the difficulties our brothers and sisters are currently encountering in the Caribbean due to the recent hurricanes. I'm pleased to announce that, with effect from the 1st of October, Guyana will be chairing the Council of Core, the CARICOM Council of Core here in New York. Secondly, His Excellency mentioned about the difficulties our brothers and sisters are currently encountering in the Caribbean due to the recent hurricanes. I'm pleased to announce that, with effect from the 1st of October, Guyana will be chairing the Council of Core, the CARICOM Council of Core here in New York. But because of the situation, it was advanced, so we are spearheading through yours truly the mobilization of relief efforts for our brothers and sisters affected by the hurricanes. So kindly collect a flyer behind, which will give you the areas and the locations where we are asking persons to drop off their donations. Just this week we heard about Dominica. So we are really trying to mobilize efforts, not only in terms of supplies. Later, late October, November, we will be having a day of prayer for Caribbean brothers and sisters to generate funds as well. So please take this opportunity not only to meet with His Excellency the President, but to meet with fellow Guyanese and to exchange information. Let us resolve to unite and live the true meaning of our national motto. And I want to hear from you.
One people, one nation, one destiny.
Thank you very much. Wow.